heard your cries, Guggen Nation, but too much of a good thing is bad for your health. So we're only doing this once a week. Buckle up, baby. It's time for E.T.N. Brought to you by Lloyd's Construction and Consulting, providing first-class construction services on 1010XL.
Well, it's bad for someone's health. We'll find out whose. William is our guest Guggen judge today.
Willie.
You will abide by his rulings. Good morning, William.
Good morning. Can you hear me okay?
We can.
Yes, sir. Thanks
loud
for the time.
Loud and clear.
Wow.
So,
Beef, are you giving him a prize pack?
Yeah, I'm very excited to be joined by Will I Am of the Black Eyed Peas. He's going to go home with $25. I don't know if he needs it. To Scrubble's Ultimate Car Wash.
Wonderful.
He'll be able to use that to get his car all cleaned up, looking spiffy. And he'll also be entered into the drawing to possibly win a pairing into next Monday's Coastal Equipment Guggen Open.
It's coming fast. Again, we lost
right around the corner.
We lost a lawsuit with the Masters, and in order to not take away from their spotlight, we've had to move to the Monday after the Masters rather than the Monday of. But, you know, that's okay.
Bunch of haters over there.
Yeah. That'll work.
Shall we?
We don't want to ruin it for the nationwide golf fans.
Let's play the game.
Round one.
Last night, Baylor makes reasonably easy work of Gonzaga in the national title game, ending Gonzaga's run for a perfect season. They're popping, like Jeff said, popping corks in Indiana as the Hoosiers remain the last undefeated national champion. So, obviously, it was a one-sided affair. So, was Gonzaga overrated, or did we overlook Baylor in your estimation?
Excuse me. Sorry about that. I think a little bit of both. I don't know if we overlooked Baylor. This is 1-2 in the preseason. Everybody's known how good Baylor was. So rather than maybe underrating them, maybe we underlooked them. You know, we didn't give them quite enough credit, and we gave Gonzaga all this credit because we saw until the UCLA game, Gonzaga winning every game by 20 points. And Baylor was impressive throughout the tournament as well. It makes you wonder if these two teams played in December if we would have been, you know, a little more cognizant of what was going to happen last night. Because to me, what the surprise was that the game was a blowout. You know, the fact that Baylor won the ball game isn't, you know, in super surprising. It's the fact that they beat them like they did.
It's a good answer, Jeff, but as you know, I'm the CBE this year, so what I says goes as the noted college basketball expert. And the story is we gave Baylor too much credit. Gonzaga. We gave Gonzaga too much credit. Gonzaga was a really good team, man, really good. But you know what? They're kind of like the UConn of – men's basketball, as UConn women go. They're in a bad conference. And when they're in a bad conference, you get 20 games where you're not tested and you don't have that. You don't have to show that medal. And Baylor came up and hit them in the mouth, and it was a little tough for Gonzaga to respond. And I honestly feel like if there had been a couple more tests along the way, perhaps they might have been a little bit more prepared. But, yeah, Baylor, to the victors go the spoils, best team in college basketball. And we just followed Gonzaga because they never lost, and we wanted that storyline to be there. But in the end, it wasn't. Baylor's the best team.
In the end, I think there was just a whole lot more wisdom with Jeff. Winner, Jeff.
Round two.
No, if you know this, William, but I am the college basketball expert. And Jeff's got it down the pee pants.
I think you've told him that 3 or 4 times.
I think I'm not sure what happened there.
You've told him 4 times in 2 minutes.
Round two.
Certain modicum of respect that goes along with the CBE title.
We did mention the Guggen Open will be this coming Monday because it is Masters Week.
Oh.
The Masters begins Thursday.
Oh.
You know, Lee Westwood said it's playing as fast as he's ever seen it.
Yes. So is Hidden Hills, by the way.
Yes.
So be ready.
Blazing hard greens up there. You know, the winning score, the only time outside of the plus one from Danny Willett, the lowest winning score this century has been 5 unders. So is that in danger if Lee Westwood's correct? Do you think the winning score will be higher than 5 under, or will they go low like Dustin did last year at 20 under or in that ballpark?
All right. Well, they're not going to go 20.
Well, no.
Okay, because that you know.
Usually it's like 10, 12, 13.
Yeah, different time of year. But with all due respect to Lee Westwood, I'm willing to make any type of bet that the winning score is better than 5 under. So, you know, Lee, you got to win a major before I take what you take into account. So thank you for your comments, but I enjoy and look forward very much to watching All 4 days of the Masters.
Because you play Augusta 20 times, you have to win it to notice that the course
is playing different.
I mean, the guy's been there 20 years. He's been playing great golf. I think his point was more, you know, in line with if you think they're going to want him to go 20 under again this time, think again because it will play a little harder and faster. But here's what's funny about that. And they're just going to play firmer and faster. And so... So what? So they're all going to – did I miss something? Or half the field going to play the courses that was in November and the rest are going to play it firm and fast? Look, here's what you do. You want to find out who's going to win among the guys that you like. Find out which one's putting best because the one thing about fast and firm, that's not going to slow Bryson DeChambeau down. It'll just hit it even further. But when you get on those greens, the guys who can manage those greens, I probably – that old stat they love to throw at you on Saturday, strokes gained putting, find that guy and you'll find your winner.
You know, I don't think, Jeff, you answered the question.
Oh, no.
So, Dan, that was a lot of wisdom, but I think you're both wrong. I think it's going to be 4 under.
Okay. Oh, wow. All right.
But winner, Dan.
Round three.
Thank you, William. I'll take that.
Round three.
Yes, sir.
Another trade in advance of the NFL draft. It won't necessarily affect what happens at the top. Yesterday, the Panthers acquired Sam Darnold from the Jets for a 6th this year, as well as a 2nd and 4th next year. It seems like the Panthers will be out of the QB hunt at number 8, or maybe they anticipate none of them being available at number 8. Is Sam Darnold in any way, shape, or form, in your estimation, an upgrade for them over what they had last year with Teddy Bridgewater?
If you're talking about potential, it's the only way you can say that. We've documented this. I'm not going to now go to my computer and pull up Sam Darnold and how low he was in QBR and completion percentage and all of those measurables. We've done this. He's somewhere between 28 and 35, it seems like, every year the last 3 years. So I think that the Panthers got absolutely swashbuckled. They're sitting a 2nd and a 4th next year, a 6th this year, and, by the way, paying the last year of Darnold's contract in full on their own. And there are some that say, whoa, Joe Brady, look what he did with Joe Burrow. Okay, that's fair. He did wonders with Burrow at LSU. That's college football. It's not the NFL. I didn't see that same Joe Brady magic with Teddy Bridgewater last year, or we wouldn't be having this conversation. So potential, that's what this trade is for. Because when it comes to actuality, Sam Darnold hasn't shown us any.
Well, I, you know me, and you know how I feel about this. If you've listened to the program, and I'm just going to add on to it because it needs to be added on. It's not between 28 and 35. It's last. I mean, Sam Darnold was last year in quarterback rating. And we talk about, you know, we sit here and argue, is 90 a good rating? Okay? We go back and forth on that, William. Is 90 a good rating? Is 90 a good rating? Well, I'll tell you what's not a good rating. 72. That ain't a good rating, okay? I'll tell you what else ain't good. 38 starts and 13 wins. 1 out of every 3. That ain't good. I'll tell you what else ain't good. And again, this is 3 years now. You know, this is 3 years and we're not getting better. Under 60% completion percentage. That ain't good. I'll tell you what else ain't good. 39 picks and only 45 touchdowns. The touchdown-to-pick ratio. So I don't see it in any way, shape, or form. You're better off with Teddy Bridgewater.
So I guess you both said that Sam Darnold is terrible, but Jeff didn't pander and have to use my name in his answer. So winner, Jeff.
Round 4.
Wow. Pandering.
William is tough.
William, which circuit are you working for as a judge? You're like a real judge. That's what they'll throw at you, too, by the way.
Thank you.
Order in my court!
Why do you do that? Why do you
have to hit the table? Every time I pound the desk here, gang, we lose a hearing in one ear for like a minute, and then it'll be back.
It's very old wiring.
I do it every day.
It's a historical landmark. We should be kind to it.
Tomorrow, I'm going to relieve myself on the desk, so look forward to that.
Speaking of quarterbacks and getting good quarterback play, on the reverse side of the Sam Darnold spectrum, a guy who is actually known to be pretty good, in fact, a former MVP, Lamar Jackson. Sammy Watkins has joined Baltimore, and he said that with the right weapons and receivers getting open, Lamar Jackson could be a 4,000, 4,500-yard passing QB in this league. His high watermark in his MVP year was 3,100 yards and 36 touchdowns. So do you agree with Sammy Watkins' estimate that with the right pieces in place, Lamar Jackson could be that high-volume passer?
But Sammy Watkins ain't the right piece. So that's the problem. Sammy Watkins is not the even the player that Buffalo drafted. Sammy Watkins had 37 catches last year for 400 yards.
A great
you know
player.
What that makes him? That makes him like the fifth receiver on a team. Okay? I mean, so that's to be determined. But I'll tell you this, the Ravens better find a receiver in the draft. And by the way, if I'm Baltimore also, because I already have 160-pound Hollywood Brown, whoever I draft down there at 27, it's going to be a bigger receiver. We got to get some size out there as well to help Lamar Jackson. And the jury's still out on Lamar Jackson, but if you want to bring in the Sam Darnold comparison, it's like night and day. You're much better off with Lamar Jackson. So I'm excited if I'm the Ravens, if I have Lamar Jackson, who's won an MVP award and is and has a great skill set to see what he can do. But Sammy Watkins ain't the answer.
This is flawed in so many ways. First of all, that is categorically, unequivocally, 100% so false it's not even funny. Has anyone ever said NFL teams don't get better, they get better wide receivers? No, of course not. Receivers don't ever, never have made quarterbacks. Quarterbacks make receivers. So to your point, yeah, Sammy Watkins wouldn't be the one to turn to. But if it was Tyreek Hill going to the Ravens, Lamar Jackson isn't suddenly going to be a precision passer like Patrick Mahomes. So, no, this one's silly. Quarterbacks make receivers. It's not the other way around.
I got to go with Dan on this one.
Yes. Sorry, didn't mean to pander.
Round five.
And lastly, round five.
Felt pretty good about that one. Ouch.
Dan, you know, one of your favorite bits.
Yes.
Is the power ranking.
Yes.
I'm not doing an NFL power ranking. I'm not doing an NFL power ranking.
No.
But on the hardwood.
Yeah.
On the association side.
Yeah.
The latest batch of the power rankings is out.
Okay.
With the reshaped squads in the NBA.
Okay.
And I have to scroll a long ways. I got to get down to number 8 before I see the reigning NBA champions, the Los Angeles Lakers. I know they're dealing with some injury concerns, but are we doing this again? Are we once again counting out the king?
Look, I'm going to take this as the power rankings for as we sit today with teams in their current condition. Because newsflash, with LeBron and Anthony Davis, the Phoenix Suns and Utah Jazz will have been nice little regular season stories. LeBron and Anthony Davis and the Lakers will win the West. So I don't care if you put them 30 in the power rankings. It doesn't matter. I don't care if they have to do the play-in game. If LeBron and AD are healthy, then the Lakers will be the favorite. So you can power rank them wherever you want.
I know what you're saying, but listen, it does matter in terms of where they finish. Not necessarily the power rankings, but that's a byproduct of what we're talking about. And it, only in this respect, it's going to make it a lot tougher for the Lakers in the West if you got to go through three really good teams. There's a chance there to slip up, and then you're going to get the Brooklyn Nets in the finals. I think it's going to be tough for LeBron James and Anthony Davis, who has not played a lick of basketball in 2 or 3 months, to just jump in and turn it right back on again. So I think it does matter a little bit in terms of who you have to play and how you have to play them in the playoffs. It's a much tougher road coming out of the 6, 7, 8 seed than being 1 or 2.
Wow, you both brought a whole lot of wisdom there, but I've never known a winner that wet his pants. Winner, Dan.
Yeah! Yes, sir!
Wow.
Yes, sir!
High and dry. High and dry.
High and dry.
Thank you, William.
William's yeah. Gonna,
William's going to get his car clean.
I'm going to sip me a little fireball right here.
William
right now. Just a touch to get me going through the rest of the day.
Just a little sipski.
It's mixed in. A little cinnamony beef.
Why not?
You in?
Oh, always.
Fireball. So good.
I just peed a little.
So good.
Regrettable.